Take control of your mind and your thoughts and focus on your breathing. Feel the power of you, the real you, controlling your breathing. The real you is always present right now. You are more powerful than you can ever begin to imagine, because you get to focus on the greatest gift ever. Now, your presence, where your attention is being drawn to now, no matter what's going on outside your mind. Feel the power of your breathing. There are astronomical numbers of things going on in one breath. That's how powerful you are. That's how powerful your determination is. So let's use that power. Let's use that third eye, that mind's eye that we all have. Let's use it right now. And let's see ourselves doing the best we can on all the stretches and exercises today in our gym period. Gym. G-Y-M. Grow your mind. And here we are in the gym of life. Growing our minds and growing our bodies. Taking control of what we truly are. Simply being. Human being, the most powerful energy thing in the universe. That's who you really are. So see yourself right now. See it in your mind. Because whatever you see in your mind, you can make real with your eyes open. Everything created with your eyes closed can be made real. With your eyes open.
around the world. Cause I want to. All on the dance, all in the trance, all over around the world. Cause I want to. One time for the girls that's marching forward. Two times for the boys that's walking forward. Three times for the ones do what they want to. Each time when I'm gonna do what I want to. I can do what I want to. I'm so nonchalant too. We global from LA to Paris, São Paulo.
Eu faço o que eu quero, eu sou muito louco. Tô no mundo inteiro, São Paulo pro todo.
You're perfect. São Paulo.
Eu faço o que eu quero, eu sou muito louco. Tô no mundo inteiro, São Paulo pro todo.
You're perfect.
Hi again, everyone. We are on the final page of Satguru's wisdom and sharing his top 10 rules for success. And my favorite one, or one of my favorites, is number 10, which is always do your best. It's really simple. You hear it all the time, either from our parents, from family members, friends, teachers. Always do your best. It is not easy to do, because in a moment when we've made a mistake, we tend to dwell on the fact that we experienced a sense of loss. Let's free ourselves from that by falling in love with the process of what we're trying to create. We're trying to create our best self. That is the business that is our responsibility. It's the business of living. So as we go on this path from going from mind power to mind wealth, let's be freed by the fact that we're all going to make lots of mistakes. But if we're doing our best each and every moment to learn from every decision, then we're already there. We're in that process. Have a great day, everybody.
Hello, everyone. Welcome, welcome, welcome. So what is tapping? Very briefly, for those of you new, we call it tapping because we are literally physically tapping on endpoints of meridians of our body while focusing on the stress, the anxiety, the pain, whatever is in our way. And what the latest research has shown is that when we tap on these endpoints of meridians while focusing on this stressful issue, we send a calming signal to the amygdala in the brain. And I know that you'll all know the amygdala is the fight, flight, or freeze response center in our brain. It's a part of us that when we're overwhelmed, when we're on Facebook, when we're reading the news, when we're interacting with family members, and we feel stress, anxiety, overwhelm, too much coming at us, too much to do, lack of clarity on decisions, overwhelm, pain in our bodies, stomach upset, everything we're looking at, underneath it all, that amygdala is firing. Underneath it all, that stress response is happening. So let me say that again. Family relationships, pain in our bodies, the news, COVID, all these things. Any place in your life where you feel stuck, where you feel like something isn't working properly, where you want something to change, I guarantee you that associated with that challenge is a stress response somewhere. Somewhere along the way, your body's activating that stress response. Now, a challenge with that stress response in particular is what happens when we're stressed? The blood flows away from our forebrain into our arms and legs, right? Fight, flight, or freeze. Why is it called that? Because it's a part of us that is designed to fight, to freeze, to run, to do something about it. So the blood flows away from our brain into our arms and legs, away from our digestion, away from growth and repair into our arms and legs. So imagine this. You have a financial challenge. You're stressed about an upcoming bill. You started a project that's not going right where you think it's going to go. You want to write a book, but you keep getting stuck. You have this stress response firing. You think about the bill. You think about the mortgage. You think about everything you have to do. That stress response is firing. Now imagine we activate this. So we think, okay, when that fight or flight response is firing, I'm like being chased by a tiger or a lion, this ancient response, right? This ancient response to danger. So there you are. You're being chased by a tiger or a lion or a bear or whatever you want to imagine. You're feeling that stress. And I come jogging up next to you and I say, hey, I see you're having a challenge getting started on that book. I've got some ideas for you. What if you do this first? You look at me and you go, Nick, there's a tiger chasing me. Right? Or I come to you and I go, hey, you know, I know you're being chased by a tiger right now, but tell me about your dreams and goals. What's your vision for your life? What do you want to create in the world? What are you going to create today? And then you say, hey, I don't know if you noticed, but there's a tiger chasing me. When we are in this fight or flight response, we don't have the resources. We don't have the skill set. We don't have the blood in our brain to make the decisions to transform our lives. What's so powerful about tapping, what's so powerful about anything that turns off that response, that brings us to that place of peace, is that when we do that, we activate our inner resources. We activate all that goodness and creativity and joy. All those things are available when we allow ourselves to relax, when we allow ourselves to feel safe, when we release trauma from the past, when we begin conditioning our body to let go. And if we look around at society, if we look around at, you know, even work, most work environments are like, go, 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 push, push, push. You're not doing enough. You got to do more. Get through the to-do list, overwork, overwork, get it done, get it done. And certainly, yes, there's times to do that. But what happens when we do that? I mean, how many of you have started something, had all this fire and energy? I mean, I did, you know, I went to UPW in 2001, my first Tony event, right? So it's like you do the weekend, you come off the weekend, and you are just charging out the door. The next 3 days, you're planning and this and that and the other. You're just burning the midnight oil. And then by the fourth day, you're like, I'm done. I got nothing, right? I've used it up. Willpower, this energy, it's a muscle. It is something that runs out. But I'm going to propose all the times we meet as your growth day coach when I come back is that there is a way to create that energy when you need it. And then there's a way to rest when you need to rest. There's a way to be focused and disciplined while being relaxed at the same time. And that is what's possible when we begin to train our body to feel differently, to relax, to let go. So, you know, the theme for this month is wellness. And certainly tapping is very associated with wellness. What do we have when we're looking at wellness? We have food, diet, really important. We have supplements, the right medicines for you, whatever you need, that extra care. We have exercise, we have sleep, we have these staples. Then we have this new world of stem cells and biohacks and this, that, and the other. And I'm a fan of all that. I listen to all the podcasts and I try the supplements and I do this, that, and the other. But I've been thinking a lot recently about those external things. And we're certainly conditioned as a society to think, oh, well, give me that bottle of pills. And what, you know, most people are conditioned to go to the doctor. I'm feeling this audience is not, right? They don't take too many white pills, hopefully. But this audience probably takes a lot of brown and weird colored pills, right? Where we go, okay, I'm not into the doctor stuff, but the supplements I'm into. And I'm with you. I mean, the amount of money I've spent on supplements in my life is dramatic. And potentially, many of them are great. But if I have to stack a bottle of something, an external bottle of something that someone manufactured, someone that someone else told me to get, that someone said this is going to be good for me. Just think about that. So this is the stack. This is the competition we have here. We have this bottle of something that someone else told you to take that maybe you can digest, maybe you can't, maybe it's good for your liver, maybe it's not, who knows? Or we have this tapping thing. We have this weird thing where we're tapping on endpoints of meridians of our body. We stack the two, and this is what I see. The supplements, I don't know what it's going to do. It might be good, might actually be bad. I hate to say it, right? Some people are like, nope, you don't need that, or your liver doesn't do well with that, or it does nothing, and you're paying a lot of money for it. That costs money too, by the way. Or we have this thing where what's happening when we do it? What's happening when we tap these endpoints of meridians? What's happening when we acknowledge the feelings that we feel in our body? We immediately lower cortisol. So research study that's been done on tapping, it was just replicated, meaning it was done again by a different researcher. There were three groups. They all spit into a tube, their saliva. They measured cortisol before and after. Cortisol, the main stress hormone. When you're stressed, when you're overwhelmed, cortisol is high. It peaks and valleys throughout the day, but too much cortisol means too much stress. Huge number of damaging effects to the body that any doctor or scientist or researcher will acknowledge. So three groups, they spit in a tube. One group did an hour of tapping. The other group did an hour of psychoeducation. Hey, let's learn about stress and the body and how it responds. And the third poor, sad group just read magazines for an hour. The tapping group, 43% reduction in cortisol in 1 hour, which is a dramatic decrease. The psychoeducation group, a 19% decrease in cortisol. So that's a nice solid drop, potentially gives us some clues about how when we are learning something, when we are relaxing just because we're feeling hopeful, because we're activating our minds, we lower some of the stress in our bodies. So even just by listening to me now, according to that research, and that poor third group reading magazines for an hour, their cortisol went up 2%. So sitting there, maybe bored, I like to say, hey, let's do that study again with Facebook. How about your Facebook newsfeed? See what that does to your cortisol. Maybe go on Instagram, maybe read the news. Let's see what that does to your cortisol. So we see a clear definition of a dramatic drop in cortisol from tapping on endpoints of meridians of our body. And what happens when you lower the cortisol? That's just one effect. When you lower the cortisol, when you relax your body, everything works better. There is zero doubt, and you've all had the experience, when you are more relaxed, your body works better. It's not like maybe, or, oh, I hope I take the right supplement, or there's no ifs, ands, or buts. if you are more relaxed, if you release tension from your body, if you release stress from your life, your body works better. End of story. No one's arguing. Now, if we look at diet, for example, food diet, really important, but we can't decide what to eat, right? So no one knows. Diet itself is so stressful for people. You know, I have a gut health meditation inside the app. And I just heard from someone who said that she used it for 3 weeks. She had had gut problems for a year, had tried everything. Nothing had worked. She did it once a week for 3 weeks. And she says she is completely transformed. In that gut meditation, one of the things that I go over is just the stress of food. We have supplements, we have diet, we have all these external things that we're doing our best with. We're trying to control, we're trying to live a healthier life, we're trying to stay up to date with the podcast, but it is challenging because we don't have definitive answers. What we do have definitive answers about is the fact that if you release stress and anxiety in your body, if you let go of that anxiety, if you find a way to calm down more than you have before, everything will work better in your life.
Tedder. Here's Eric Lee. High! Oh, that's a remarkable goal. Lehigh has two, Forest have two.
Good morning, Believe Nation and Determination. Yesterday, we looked at you as being the CEO of your life, making decisions that will propel you towards your infinite mind wealth. Today, I want us to look at ourselves as player one in the ultimate game, the mind game. And how do we win the mind game? Because once we do, we can have anything we can ever dream of or desire. We have to realize we are a magnet. So you're in this game today and each and every day. You are a magnet and you have the two greatest weapons. You have believe, you have determination. Those two things are weapons that you use to attract all positive things. So all positive thoughts. You do this over and over in the game and eventually you will suffocate all the negative thought space that's in your mind and win the mind game. Have a great day, everybody.
It's like you really are your only comparison group, especially as you get older, because your life is so idiosyncratic and peculiar. I mean, look, you have to care what other people think. It's stupid to think otherwise because you have to be social and you have to be aware of what other people are doing and all of that. So this isn't psychopathic individuality, but it is genuinely true that no one has your set of opportunities and limitations. And so the comparison just isn't real. It can't be sufficiently multidimensional. I've met many people who are very, very rich and you can look at their lives and they have these huge houses and material plenty and they're shielded from many catastrophes that would hit someone without those resources harder, but their lives are still full of exactly the same troubles that characterize human life in general. And so you compare yourself on one dimension. You don't see, well, the person's worked 80 hours a week for 40 years and it's blown all his relationships out of the water. It's like, yes, he's rich, but he's also old now, and one of the best predictors of wealth is age. You know, really, do you want to be young and poor or old and rich? It's like, I'd pick young and poor because you can't buy you. And that's something that's worth considering. But you don't know what burdens the people you're jealous of. So leave it be. It's not helpful to you to be envious.
Need motivation?
Watch the thing with Believe Nation.
Hey, it's Evan Carmichael, and I make these videos because you are probably the most ambitious person in your circle.
But you know you're capable of more.
And you get that push by surrounding yourself with the best.
So today, let's learn from one of the best, Jordan Peterson, and my take on his top 50 rules of success. Enjoy.
If you know what you want, then you know when you're failing. If you don't allow yourself to know what you want, you can keep that foggy. If you don't set out the conditions for your success, then you can avoid your responsibility because, again, that's not clear. And the problem with wanting something is that in all probability, you're going to have to work for it. You're going to have to make sacrifices. And it's certainly possible that you want to avoid that. You might be afraid to make it clear because other people could deny it to you too, which is something I write about a fair bit in that chapter. The problem is, and failing to make any of that clear protects you right now, but it's really hard on you over the medium to long term, because if you don't make it clear to yourself what you want or to other people, the probability that you're just going to stumble into it is pretty low. And you can put that off indefinitely day after day, but the problem with that is that you age while you're doing that, and there's obviously a price to be paid for that. So that's chapter three, do not hide things in the fog. I mean, it's a warning about failing to pay attention. You know, knowledge emerges in a very strange way. It emerges, obviously, when we learn something, we started out by not knowing it. And so what that means is that knowledge goes through a transformation process from being absolutely not there to being explicit and fully detailed. And one step of that process is emotion. And so, for example, you might find yourself frustrated, disappointed about the events of the day, but be unable to exactly specify why. That's extremely common. You know, you go home to your partner and you be in a bad mood and, you know, you'll snap at them for something and they'll say, well, what's up with you? And you'll say, well, nothing. You're just being annoying, when it's perfectly clear to both of you that there is actually something up with you. And then that disappointment and frustration, anger and sadness, let's say, or anxiety, is a sign that something isn't right. But it isn't necessarily that you're repressing knowledge of what's not right. It's that you actually don't know. Mm. And the emotion is the first step in the process by which that knowledge emerges. And you might have to sit and think and talk to your partner or to a friend for God only knows how long before you're actually going to put your finger on what it is that you're upset about. And it could be very far removed from whatever happened to trigger you in the moment. And so that's the fog. And you can keep things in the fog just by not doing that. It's really easy. It's no more difficult than just sitting there doing nothing, because creating knowledge is active and difficult.
The best advice that you can really give to people who are young is that unless you have very good reason not to, you should do what all people have always done. And so what does that mean? When I see my clinical clients, although I'm not practicing anymore, when I saw my clinical clients, I would evaluate their lives across a number of dimensions. Were they immersed in a network of friendships? Did they have a family? That could be their family of birth, but also the family that they've produced, their own husband or wife and children, if they were of an age where that was appropriate. Did they have a career or at least a job? And was their job productive and matched well with their abilities and their ambitions? Were they educated to the extent that their intelligence and curiosity might demand? Were they in reasonable physical and mental health, independent of those other areas? All of those things need to be established, and you don't want to question them so much that you don't establish them. You might think of yourself as a rebel and someone who's particularly unique, and it's also possible that you are unique in one or more ways, but fundamentally speaking, if you don't do what everyone else does, then the probability that you're abdicating your responsibility and that you will miss out on something important is extremely high. So, you know, our culture, virtually every movie that's made for children now, you see this coming out of the Disney studios constantly, always concentrates on the special child who's got abilities that no other child has and is being crushed by society into being, you know, unpleasantly normal. And there is a fair bit of crushing that goes along with being socialized, because part of being socialized is to become like everyone else. But you don't want to underestimate the benefit of that. It's very, very difficult to tread your own path, and you're only going to be able to do that in a limited number of areas. You blow apart the social routines, you'll find yourself out there in a domain of chaos that will overwhelm you, and that's not pleasant. You do not want that.
With regards to your goals, let's say you don't know what to do. Well, maybe you're high in openness, and so you're pulled in all sorts of directions, or maybe you're low in conscientiousness, or you're confused because you're anxious, or you haven't had any direction, you haven't had good mentoring, et cetera, et cetera. There's lots of reasons. Well, I would say pick something, right? Pick something, a nameable goal, and then try to implement it. And what'll happen is you'll learn a lot by trying to implement it. And one of the things you might learn is what a slightly better goal might be. You know, because if you try something diligently and you succeed or you fail, you're going to learn from the effort expended in the detailed implementation of the goal. It's going to inform you. It'll also transform you physiologically. It does that at a very basic level, neurophysiological level. You will be slightly different as a consequence of the attempt. And what that'll mean is that the next goal you pick will be a little more suited to you. And so it's this kind of pathway, right? It's like maybe the goal you should be attaining is here, but you don't know that because you're clueless. And so you aim there. Well, it's better than there. And it's not nothing. It's not cessation of movement. And, you know, if you're supposed to go there and you go here, but you walk diligently towards it, you're a little closer once you get to here than you were here. And it's this oscillating self-corrective process that leads you to the final star. And you have to be willing to engage in erroneous experimentation to manage that, but it is a self-correcting process. And so one of the things I always talk to my clients about is, well, let's try something, you know, and we'll reserve to ourselves the right to alter our trajectory. And then I would use as a corrective there, because you might say, well, how do you know when you're not just giving up, right? Instead of thinking maybe you need a different goal. And I would say, well, you can, if you're really concerned about your proclivity for self-deception, you can enter into a contract with yourself that you won't replace any goal you've set with a goal that's easier. And so you can switch your goal, but it has to be a little harder so that you check yourself against that tendency to withdraw and avoid and be self-deceptive. And that works like a charm. And if you do that with some degree of diligence, your goals will get better and more attainable, and you'll get happier too, because you don't experience happiness except in relationship to a goal. And that's really worth knowing. You know, and that's another thing to think about too. If your life is meaningless, well, you're not pursuing a valued goal. I mean, you might be depressed too, and sometimes that can be like an illness, you know, or something that is really wrong with you. But a good rule of thumb is that if you find no joy in life, there's a very low probability that you're pursuing a goal that you regard intrinsically, like in the depths of your temperament, as worthwhile. And that's technically true, because we do in fact experience most of the positive emotion, let's say, that's associated with emotions like joy. We experience that in relationship to a goal. So, well, then you want to find a goal that regulates your negative emotion and that brings you a certain amount of positive emotion and that expands your competence as you pursue it. And you will experience that as meaningful. That's really what.
Tell me that you need me to help you find a way through all of this madness. Can I be a light of day? Please won't you believe me? Even if you don't agree, know that I'm trying to help us all break free. Oh, no. There'll be nothing left for no one. No, there'll be nothing left for no one. If you don't stop living your life, turn to one side with a blind eye. There'll be nothing left for no one, for no one.
Left for no one.
for no one, for no one. Good morning, Believe Nation and Determination. Today, in our top 10 rules for success journey, we are introduced to Warren Buffett. He is another one of my heroes. This man has the greatest mindset, which has allowed him to be the greatest investor of the 20th century. So today he shares with us three words that he looks for when hiring people: intelligence, integrity, and energy. I love these words. As you know, they're part of my life mission. I truly believe we are infinite, intelligent, determined, integrated investors, thinkers, human beings. So if we can use those three words in our day-to-day thinking, we can become anything we want to be. So it works in investing. I think of us as human investment machines in every decision we make. So look at every decision you make and what you think today as an investment. Have a great day, everybody.
Life is always now. This seems almost too obvious to state, but most people live in a way that almost contradicts the simple fact that life is always now. They live as if some future moment were more important than this moment. So most people always live towards the next moment. They're always on their way towards the next moment. So if they get very old, then usually they live in the past and they still don't live in the present moment. So we're not talking here about making plans and on a practical level, all this is necessary and great, making plans, what to do with your life or what to do the next day. But most people are never at home in the present moment. There's always something missing. There's an inner feeling that I need to get to the next moment where I will find some kind of completion or fulfillment. But when they get to the next moment, another next moment appears that they need to get to.
Need motivation?
Watch a top 10 with Believe Nation.
Hey, it's Evan Carmichael, and I make these videos because in my first business, I struggled to believe in myself. I quit on my business partner. And the thing that saved me was watching the successful stories of entrepreneurs. They gave me the inspiration to keep going, as well as the strategies of what to do. And quite honestly, I still need their stories and motivation today as well. So today, listen from one of the best, Eckhart Tolle, and my take on his top 10 rules of success. Enjoy.
So there's first of all, the simple fact that life is always now. So we can learn, instead of continuously ignoring the present moment, we can first of all realize the amazing fact that your entire life is experienced in and as the present moment. Life is never not the present moment. So it's the most precious thing we have. We could say it's the only thing we have, because the future, what we call the future, never actually comes. Nobody has ever experienced the future. because the moment the so-called future comes, we experience it as the present moment. Mm-hmm. Again, the past, when we talk or think about the past, we can only do that in the present moment. So even thinking about the past and thinking about future, it ultimately happens in the present moment. Now, when we are always mentally projecting forward into the next moment, we miss the aliveness and vitality of this moment, which is ultimately all there ever is. I think it's an amazing realization that many, many people never actually get to a place where they are able to, except for brief moments, where they're able to come into a good relationship with the present moment. It's amazing, there are millions of people on the planet who live in an almost antagonistic relationship with the present moment. They don't want to be where they are, they'd rather be somewhere else. They may be engaged in some kind of activity, but they'd rather be doing something else, or they'd rather be already at the end of this particular activity. They may be with somebody, but they don't really want to be with them, they'd rather be somewhere else. You know, the bumper sticker on some cars that says it's like things like, I'd rather be golfing, I'd rather be fishing. So there's this strange fact that the present moment is treated by people internally either as antagonistic, I just need to get to some better moment, or as a means to an end. It's always a means to an end. So when you are engaged in an activity, you're already mentally projecting yourself to the next moment where the activity comes to an end, or whatever you want to achieve through the activity. So it's like being on a journey and all mentally projecting yourself to the destination and not realizing that the journey takes, let's say you're on a journey, it takes a week. Arriving at the destination is one brief moment and there you are. It takes 1 week to get there, but if you reduce the value of the steps that you are taking in this moment, if you reduce that to always only a means to an end, then your entire life becomes a means to an end. Mm-hmm. An end that never really arrives, because when you arrive at that moment, then something else immediately pops up that you need to reach.
Rule number two is challenge yourself.
You need the challenge and you need to challenge yourself. If you want to create something, if you want to bring about some change in this world, you want to make your life, your so-called life, better, you are looking to achieve this or to learn this or to acquire this, that's part of being human. We don't deny that. And if you don't want to achieve anything, let's say you have no ambition whatsoever, you say, oh, it's all pointless, because you don't want to be, you don't want to challenge yourself, then life will challenge you even more. If you challenging yourself would be even to engage in physical activity and jogging, you're challenging yourself, or you're lifting weights, you're challenging the body on a physical level. The only way you can make the body stronger, the physical body, is by making, I'll put it like this, it's a strange way of putting it, but it's true. You have to make life difficult for your body, otherwise it doesn't get stronger. Well, to lift a weight is, I mean, if you ask the body, would you rather have a good, just relax or lift this weight? Oh no, I just want to relax. I don't want to make my life more difficult than it needs to be, so I just, okay, you don't get stronger without that. But when you make life difficult for the body, then more energy is demanded and more energy comes flowing in.
Energy doesn't come until you demand it. There's a request or a demand for energy because there's a gap between what you want and what, at the moment, the body doesn't have enough energy, and suddenly it comes. And then you reach a point when an influx of energy starts, then it's no longer perceived that you make life difficult for your body. Once the energy starts flowing, the body enjoys this flow of energy. But before the energy starts flowing, life was difficult for the body. And so you meet the threshold of life gets difficult for the body, and then energy comes in, and then suddenly not even perceived as difficult anymore. And that you may experience it every day when you start exercising.
Rule number three is align to deeper purpose.
When I look at you, first thing I would see is your personality, and of course the physical body and the personality, whatever makes up your personality. But if I look more deeply, and not just look, but actually sense your presence, I know that beyond your personality, there's an essence in you that is one with the essence in me, and one could describe it as consciousness itself. The essence of who you are, the essence of who I am, is consciousness. When I recognize that consciousness, the same consciousness that in me, this consciousness beyond the conditioned self, recognizes the consciousness in you, that which is beyond your conditioned self. And that recognition is what Jesus called love. And therefore he said, love thy neighbor as thyself. But that as a separate statement, it doesn't work. But when you put it together with kingdom of heaven, then it reads, find the kingdom of heaven within you, the dimension of spaciousness. Then you will recognize your neighbor, which is anybody that you are with. Then you will recognize him or her as yourself. And this recognition that in essence you are one, that you are deeply, deeply connected, that you share the one consciousness, when you recognize them in the other, then you have suddenly an outflow of benevolence and goodwill and love, not the ego love, but true love towards which in the Old Testament, in the New Testament, is agape, spiritual love for another human being. You can sense their very beingness. So, and that's the whole secret of all spirituality. It's in the teaching of Jesus.
Rule number four is stop overthinking things.
The ability to think, of course, was a wonderful evolutionary achievement. It is associated also, it's linked to the development of language too. So gradually humans developed the ability to think, and it was a wonderful evolutionary advance. But over many, many millennia, the thinking activity began to take over. And so most human beings these days actually never stop thinking. So what they experience is what I call a voice in the head, which is the internal dialogue that most people experience throughout the day, during their waking hours. There's this continuous inner dialogue taking place, monologue, dialogue, whatever you want to call it. There's a commentator in your mind that interprets immediately and judges situations and people and thinks. It spends much more time thinking about some other moment rather than this one, and usually it's the future. And some people, of course, dwell excessively on the past too. They carry around the burden of past in their minds and in their emotional field without knowing it, without realizing that it doesn't have to be that way, without realizing that they are allowing the past, which after all is only certain thoughts that they carry in the head, they are allowing the past to sabotage their whole life. They're carrying such a burden of past that they can no longer experience the present. So you're either burdened by the past or you're burdened by the future. Now, the question of why is very important. What is the ultimate cause of this? And that is what one could call overthinking. Mm. Thinking was a wonderful thing and still is a wonderful thing, but it has taken over human beings. It has proliferated to such an extent that now thinking has become almost a parasitical entity that lives in your head that won't leave you alone. You know, most people's sense of identity, most people's sense of who they are is bound up with their mind activity, with their thinking. So they derive their sense of self from certain stories that they're telling themselves in their mind. And that's to do with what happened in the past, what other people did to you, things you identify with, that these are thoughts, things that belong to me, these are my things, these are all thought formations. Mm. So people identify with the voice in the head, and the voice in the head becomes for them impossible to distinguish from who they are. Mm. So they talk to themselves in the head. Everybody has met people in the street who talk to themselves out aloud, and usually people look at them and say, oh, there's a crazy person going. But virtually everybody does that, except that they don't do it out aloud. Mm-hmm. If you could listen into, if you walk around in the city, if you could listen to what's going on in people's heads, you would realize they're all talking to themselves.
A lot of chatter.
Yes, and they are so identified with it that they are it. The voice has taken you over. The mind activity, the conceptual mind, has taken you over, and then it virtually becomes you. So in that state, which in spiritual terms we call unconscious. Mm. When we use the word unconscious in spiritual terms, it does not have the same meaning as it has in conventional terms. Usually when we use unconscious in conventional terms, we're talking about somebody who is just dropped off, he's unconscious. When we use the word unconscious in spiritual terms, it means, it refers to somebody who is totally identified with the stream, the continuous stream of thinking, which is conditioned by the past. Mm-hmm. The types of thoughts that you think, the stories that you continuously revive in your head, have been conditioned by your past, and the past of the culture that you grew up in, the country you grew up in, all the things that make up your past, your personal past, and the collective past of your environment. So a person who grew up in, let's say, Saudi Arabia, will not be thinking the same kind of stories and will not interpret the world in the same way as somebody who grew up in Canada or in the West. But what they have in common, they are both identified with the continuous stream of thinking. They may be different stories, there may be a different sense of identity, but in both cases, they cannot separate themselves from the voice in the head.
Also, to make sure you're actually taking action after watching this video, I've designed a special free worksheet just for this video. The worksheet will highlight all of the lessons learned in this video, as well as pull out our three favorite learnings and quotes that will inspire you to actually do something. The worksheet will also give you space to write down what your key takeaways are and your specific plan of action to make sure you're getting results. If you want the worksheet designed specifically for this video, absolutely for free, there's a link in the description below. Go click on it and start building the momentum in your life and your business. I'll see you there.
Rule number 5 is awaken your consciousness.
And we end as we begin. Legs crossed. Back straight. Eyes closed. Breathing in through our nose and out through. Well, the truth is, there's no ending. There's no beginning. Today we started beginning like we always do. With our eyes closed, imagining going into the future. Only you can do that. Only we can do that. It's all possible through the power of our mind and our thoughts. But we have to control that mind and those thoughts. Because even they are not who we really are. To control our minds, to master our minds, we have to simply be here, now, present. That's our super determination. Imagine all of us united with our thoughts, mind and body, as one, all together, right now. That in itself is infinite intelligence. So as we end today, with our eyes closed, our back straight, our legs crossed, we know the truth. We're not really ending. It's never really over. We were all born to win. To be happy, peaceful, loving, kind, caring, mind wealthy, no matter what. That's the truth. The way we do that is now. Right now. They call it a present, a presence. This is the greatest gift we have, right now.